Hi, I'm Dennis Brandt from Southern California, out here at the JR Aerotow that we know well and love. The fifth year of it, we really enjoy it. Keep coming back every year. Brought something a little different this year, the Bautis Windex 1200C. It's third scale, just a tick over 4 meters. I got mine from Soaring USA, Bob Bro, who runs it. iCare also sells it from Canada. Bob set me up. This is really my first electric, so I didn't really know a whole lot about it. Just said I'd like the best power system available, and we went with the Steve New motor, 1509 series. I think it was a 6.7 gearbox. I really couldn't tell you. Bob would be the guy to call if you're interested in the whole system. We used a Castle 80 controller, and I've got a new battery, a 4900 four cell. System works really well. Pretty simple system. Got the battery up front, of course. I do have a separate onboard pack because my first flight was aerotow only, and I didn't have the power system on because the unusual configuration. We thought we'd just take a tow first, and that worked out fine. The next flight was with a tow, and then power on at altitude, and then the third flight was off the ground, and it was from then on it was fine. So. Something unique I did was, being that I wanted aerotow, I've got a tow release up in the nose, and that's also this drop dolly. Because the thrust line of the motor, of the model is, it tends to pitch up, which most of them seem to do. I put this dolly on, and it seems to cruise off the ground a little easier, and I just pop it at about 20 feet of altitude, though, and away I go. Kit's a beautiful kit. From Bautis, everything's engineered so well. He's got carbon in the right places. It's very light. There was hardly anything that's not stock in here. I did a slight modification of the motor mount just to give it a little extra. I put a little extra carbon back there because I felt a little bit of torquing. It may have been a prop out of balance initially, but whatever the case is, it's really sturdy out back there now. And 1410 APC prop, same prop I've been using the whole time. I've got a mixture of Airtronics servos on the aileron and elevator, and the high-tech digitals on the rudder and the flaps. The thing flies, for me, just like a regular sailplane. It thermals just fine. There is a little drag with the prop. The real one is it feathers. Some guys have wondered about a folding prop, but it looks kind of funky because they fold forward, and this is a little more scale looking. Not that it matters too much, but I just don't worry about the drag of the prop because the thing thermals great. So maybe at high speed it develops a little more drag, but at the thermal speed, it's just fine. It's a little bit of an unusual configuration, a little short coupled. It will spin on you if you crank it and pull it, but you just have to treat it for what it is, and it does just fine, and it really, really does thermal well.
What's nice about the Windex is it allows me to fly any field. I've got total freedom from the associated equipment of a power, a tow plane, a winch line. So I can fly anywhere without an altitude restriction because obviously at 400 feet, this gets up there pretty quick. So I need the altitude. But it's allowed me, it's opened up new areas for me to fly that I couldn't fly before.
Chris Lash, and I've been modeling for a long time, like many people, and I was looking for a project that nobody had ever done before, and that's really getting harder and harder to do. So coming to the JR Aerotow and flying these giant sailplanes really got me looking at some historical, old sailplanes maybe nobody had ever modeled before, and I found the Horton brothers and some of their flying wings. So in looking through some of the literature that's available on them, I found this airplane. It's called the Horton Parabola, and it's basically a parabolic shaped sailplane that the Horton brothers, they had some ideas about some aerodynamic ways to make sailplanes, flying wings, fly better. So they put a lot of those ideas into this airplane. And in 1937, 38, they built it. And apparently, according to any literature that's available about this airplane, the one that they had finished, it got damaged apparently in transportation to a new facility that they were moving to, and presumably they never flew it. So one of the few images that's available of the airplane is of the one that was finished in flames. They just decided, they were going to move on to some new ideas, and they just lit it on fire and burned it up. And apparently that was the last anybody had ever tried to build a parabolic-shaped flying wing. There's a lot of other airplanes that they built later that are very similar. They basically just squared off the leading edges and the trailing edges, and it's a very similar plan form. And one of the airplanes that they ended up having a lot of success with was the HO-229 bomber, which was a twin turbine-powered jet bomber. But so anyway, I decided, okay, I'm going to build this airplane. And I wanted to build it really big so it would be impressive. It's about 38% scale. There's reasons for that, but I won't go into that. But it's big, you know, it was about the size I could fit in my shop, really. So anyway, it's basically just pink styrofoam that's then sheeted with thin layers of pink styrofoam that's about 3/8 of an inch thick. The shape is, as I found out, is very, very difficult to model. It's got curves everywhere. It's got a washout. I was shooting for 6 degrees, and that's about what I ended up with. It has a very deep, thick center section with a lot of reflex, a lot of things you would normally think of with a flying wing. And over the off and on over the last 3 years, it came together and became this. And finally this year, we were able to, last year we flew it several times, that was in 2006. It was very tail heavy. It was difficult to really determine exactly where the center of gravity should be. And we made a couple of tows with it, but we didn't have a lot of success. So over the winter I fixed it and ended up adding about 20 pounds of nose weight. So now the all up weight is 45 to 50 pounds. I just pulled another 2 pounds out to fly it today. So anyway, we had a pretty good flight day before yesterday. We had 2 flights. The second flight, we got about maybe 500 feet of altitude, and I got to finally, feel what it really felt like to fly. It's very unstable in yaw. It's not too bad in pitch. It uses a combination of elevons and elevators for control, and just the tow release. There's no other controls, that's really all there is. I mean, I've flown a lot of flying wings, and I'm sure a lot of people have, but it's number one, it's so big and it's so heavy, it has a lot of energy. And actually, the couple of landings we made the other day, it as you point the nose down to try to hit a spot on the field and then start to try to flare, it builds up so much energy that it just has so much speed. And I think one of the things that the Horton brothers would have added if they'd have had time is definitely some kind of drag brakes or some spoilers, which apparently they did not have on this airplane, because it really needs it. It needs something to give it some speed control, because the way it is now, it's really, you would have to make a very, very long approach, very shallow, and bleed off a lot of airspeed before you were actually going to touch down. Otherwise, you just literally overrun the field, just like we did the day before yesterday. It's pink foam covered with about 6 ounce fiberglass cloth, epoxy, and the leading edge is a double layer of that, so it's about 12 ounces, and it's amazingly durable. It's very strong. Without all the nose weight and some of the other, some of the radio and things like that, it doesn't weigh much at all. It's very, very light without the spars in it and the landing gear and things like that. So all in all, I think it flies about as I expected. It was really a project to see, this airplane that supposedly had never flown, to see if it really would fly and how it would fly. And apparently it does. It's a shame that they never completed it, because it just looks so cool in the air. It's really has been a neat project. But at this point, I think I'll, whatever happens over the next day or two, I'll just leave it at that and make it a hangar queen for a while.
Hi, my name's Eric Myers, and I am lucky to own this 1/3 scale Fox, and just flying it here at this wonderful JR event. As you can probably see, there's something a little bit different about this Fox. I've had it for about 8 or 9 years, and originally I bought it for use for scale aerobatics. It was fun, but with an airplane like this, you do about a 3-minute flight and you're down on the ground. And so I hadn't been flying it much, and had seen that full-scale fellows had put turbines on their full-scale airplanes, and thought maybe we'd give that a try. So mounted a Ram 500, a little bit smaller engine, and eventually went with this Jetcat P70. The aircraft overall weight is about 35 pounds on takeoff, carry about a half a gallon of fuel. There's about 15, 16 pounds of thrust, so it's not going to do any torque rolls, but it has enough that it gives me a nice 5-minute thrilling ride. So it's really a fine airplane. The thing that may not be part evident in my flying, because I'm not an expert flyer, but the wings are foam with carbon and Obici, and consequently they're very rigid, and it helps doing point rolls and making it very snappy in the and sensitive in the roll axis. So that's something that really I always knew that about the airplane, and when we put the jet engine on it, it just made it that much more fun and exciting. The airplane is, as you probably have figured, equipped with JR radios. Right now I've got a 9303 in it, and I'll be converting it to the 2.4 gigahertz system here shortly. Run 8611 servos on the ailerons. I've had this airplane up to 155 miles an hour before the turbine was on it. So that I checked out the speed capability of it. I knew that I wanted to know how fast it what VNE would be, so that when I mounted the jet on it, I'd know I wouldn't have any safety concerns. Did put a GPS in it, and my cruise speed is really only about 70 or 80 miles an hour. Maximum speed with a jet is probably just a little over 100. So I don't push it too hard. Because I want to make sure the airframe stays together. It's obviously carrying about 10 more pounds than it did as a sailplane, so we want to make sure we don't overtax the airframe. But it's a lot of fun. It's really an exciting piece of machinery now, and I enjoy putting on a show with it as best I can. Engineering the engine installation was pretty simple, especially with the help of a friend of mine by the name of Wayne McCosker. Because the Fox, this is a Bruckman Fox, by the way, because it's so large, there was plenty of room for the ECU, the electronic control unit, and fuel in the fuselage. What we wanted to do, though, was create a motor mount that had an adjustable incidence, because we weren't sure what the proper incidence was going to be. And we did find out that's a pretty critical part of the conversion from a straight sailplane to a powered sailplane. In my case, I started out with the aft end of the jet higher, and I did find that had some, let's say, adverse repercussions. It caused the model to pitch down as I powered up. Of course, the more power you have, the more pitch down you have. So I did adjust the incidence, lowered the back end, and it makes it a lot easier to fly now. The fuel tank is a Dubro, I believe it's a Dubro with a Bob Violet fuel system. And of course they use the Violet header tank. And then under axle, this is an axle pilot, we've got the electronic control unit. And this P70 uses the Caro start system. So it's a very simple starting unit. All I have to do is put the throttle to full power and the electronic control unit takes over from there. So it's a little bit of extra plumbing, but it's overall it's very simple to operate. And maybe one thing I might chat about is the bifurcated exhaust. When I switched from the Ram to the P70, I literally had a lot more BTUs coming out the back end of this, and it became clear I needed to add the bifurcated exhaust. Now that of course costs a little bit in the total thrust, but it certainly saves the fin from any heat degradation, and overall it's got more than adequate thrust for what I'm looking to do. So I'm not sure if I'm going to change too many more things, but you know how technology is. You find new things, another 10 years it'll probably look different than now, but that's the fun of modeling.
Hello, my name is Mike Smith, and I'm showing you today the DG800S by CZ Model Technik. It's imported from Germany, and this model is 1/3 scale DG800. It's particularly special, and it interested me because it's a model that's fully molded carbon wings, very, very stiff, and allows you to do some things with the model that you couldn't normally do with a scale ship, in the sense that you don't really have to be so forgiving with it on speed runs and such. So after you gain all that altitude that we're so fond of in scale, you can shed it off real fast. I really enjoy the fact that you don't have to worry too much about blowing wings off of this airplane. It's nice and stiff and performs very well. The airfoil on this model is a modified MH32, and a little thicker at the root, and it gets pretty true to section out towards the tip, as far as I can tell. The model is set up, I'm currently flying it with a stylus, and having only 8 channels, it's one of those things where I kind of had to get as much functionality out of the radio as I could and still get all the control features out of it. I wanted to make sure that I at least had the separation from the tow release and the gear retract, and I was able to achieve that, but in doing the programming I had to sacrifice a couple of things. One of my favorite programming tips and tricks is to have the flaps follow the ailerons even in scale models, because it lends itself to some real crisp roll and some very efficient roll and roll control for that matter. So I had to give that up. So I have actually the flaps and spoilers are actuated out of the receiver by Y connectors, so they go off in tandem. The ailerons are separate, but as you can see the flaps don't follow. I was able to, with this, actually get the camber to work, and I'm able to change camber, the whole trailing edge of the wing. This would be my thermal setup, that's normal section, and then there's my reflex setting for the speed runs. And the other trick that I had to do was, when it came time to land the model, since I didn't have my flaps separated, I had to actuate my spoilers in conjunction with the flaps, and I decided to have a little bit of flap with full spoiler for normal field landings like we have for in these conditions out here at Monticello. Lots of room to land, you don't have to worry about doing a short tight approach. For short fields such as Torrey, where you really have to stick it on the spot and you want to make sure you come in, I've got a landing mode that gives me about 40 degrees of or 30 degrees of flaps right off the bat. And then I have the increase of flap with the spoiler as I need to adjust my glide path. and that significantly shortens my approach. So the model weighs about 30 pounds. I haven't actually put it on a scale, but I've been told it's close to 30 pounds. It's very, very, very forgiving flyer. It seems to slow down very well, especially when camber is introduced. And I have tried the best I can to get my roll rate as crisp and as fast as possible and not run out of rudder. So I have two rudder settings. This would be my throws that I have for my full rudder mix, which is designed to keep the model well coordinated in slow thermal flight. And then in fast cruise flight, I would flip the switch and go from that rudder deflection to that rudder deflection. It's about 50% of the rudder travel. And that just keeps you from over yawing the airplane at higher speeds. Pretty typical setup for me. I don't really vary that from airplane to airplane, whether it's thermal duration, F3B, or scale. That's what I like to fly. I also like to have camber follow the elevator. To me, it just makes sense. Both in the up elevator, positive camber deflection, down elevator, negative camber deflection. It just helps the airplane maintain its efficiency in the pitch function. And especially if you're doing any sort of inverted flying or any sort of negative pushover type maneuvers, having the wing help you out in section with the negative or the reflex coming in with the down elevator, it seems to perform better in those maneuvers and not bleed off so much speed. The mold work on this model is second to none. When I took it out of the box from Germany, it was absolutely flawless, and it still is because I haven't dinged it too bad. But it's just immaculate work. Such big surfaces, not a flaw in them. Highly recommend this model. CZ Model Technic, imported by Thomas Landgraf in Florida. I've flown it at Torrey Pines. I've flown it in 8-9 knot winds with no problems. Just sort of cruises around and stays nice and level with the cliff. And I've also taken it out on a 40 knot day and had a great time with it. This is my first JR aerotow, and I'm having a blast. The airplane flies fantastic. And one of my favorite things to do with this is when you do get finished with your flight, I usually end my flight at about 1,500 feet, which means I'm done flying and thermaling at that point. And we point the model at the ground and let it accelerate. And so far, I think you actually have it taped, Paul. We got it going pretty fast, dove it out of about 900 feet. And sorry we don't have any feedback for a speed on that, but it was moving. And we got about a 300-foot diameter loop out of it, so that was nice. This is what I like to do for scale. It gives you all the opportunity to hang out and soar with the big guys and do a nice job of thermaling and climbing, but it also lets you have some fun and not worry about breaking the airplane.
here, Jackie and Peter Grossman. Is there a man in there? Oh my gosh, there is.
Thank you. Thank you. scale soaring is one of the hottest trends in the RC soaring world, and our new film, Pro Aerotow, features a full hour of the latest modern and vintage scale ships, as well as pilot interviews, aircraft profiles, and lots of valuable information. This tape will also teach you the basic concepts and skills of aerotowing, with pilot interviews and easy-to-understand diagrams. Pro Aerotow also includes full-scale flying action from the 2001 U.S. National Soaring Championships and some gorgeous slope soaring footage from California's Torrey Pines. For anyone interested in the beauty of scale soaring and aerotowing, this is simply the best video available.